Good morning, everyone. I'm Ed Winnick, Editor-in-Chief of Genome Web, and I'll be your moderator today for this genome webinar. Today's webinar is entitled Expanding the Dynamic Range of MicroRNA Expression, Quantification from Liquid Biopsy. The sponsor of this webinar is QIAGEN. Our panelists today are Joe Vandesompele, Professor of Functional Cancer Genomics and Applied Bioinformatics at Ghent University and Chief Scientific Officer at BioGazelle, and Jonathan Schaefer, Senior Scientist, Product Development at QIAGEN. You may type in a question at any time during the webinar. You can do this through the control panel, which usually appears on the right side of your screen. Click on the Q&A box in the upper right side of the control panel. When you click on Send To, please select All Panelists. We will ask the panelists questions after the presentations have concluded. Okay, we're going to get started with a presentation from Joe Vandesompele.
Hello, welcome. The title of my presentation is Beyond the MicroRNA Quality Control Study Using MyScript qPCR Technology. The outline of my presentation is as follows. First, I would like to briefly introduce microRNAs and the microRNA quality control study, followed by a few highlights of the microRNA quality control study and to focus on QIAGEN's MyScript technology. Then, an extension of the microRNA quality control study that was recently conducted by QIAGEN and by Gazelle, in which we measured all human microRNAs. And I will end my presentation by a use case at Ghent, where we measure circulating microRNAs to predict outcome of children with cancer. And at the very end of my presentation, I will elaborate on BioGazelle's microRNA quantification workflow that introduces or incorporates some of the microRNA quality control study guidelines. Before I start my presentation, I would like to acknowledge all the collaborators, all the people that joined in the microRNA quality control consortium, but especially Peter Mestach, my collaborator at Ghent University, Ariane de Kank, project manager at BioGazelle, and Jonathan, Eric, and Brian from QIAGEN. So microRNAs are very short, tiny, non-coding RNAs of about 22 bases in length, and they are extremely important negative post-transcriptional regulators of protein-coding gene expression. And the figure depicts how they do this. They either inhibit protein translation by interfering with the ribosome machinery, or they target the messenger RNA for degradation using exonucleic activities. MicroRNAs play a crucial role in all physiological processes, including health and disease, and they have great potential for biomarkers or therapeutic targets. It's, however, quite technically challenging to measure microRNAs for various reasons. First of all, there is a high degree of homology between closely related family members. There are also typically small differences in expression level between samples. A 50% increase in expression is often or may have relevance when considering microRNAs. Another challenging aspect is their low abundance, especially in challenging samples such as body fluids like serum, plasma, urine, saliva. And finally, microRNAs have typical sequence variants, so-called isomers, as depicted in this figure, where at the 5' or 3' or in the middle of the sequence, tiny sequence variations may occur. Considering all this, it's quite challenging to accurately measure microRNAs. And this was the very start of the microRNA quality control study. So in this study, the goal was to compare all commercially available microRNA gene expression technologies, ranging from qPCR over microarray-based hybridization and next-generation sequencing. And you can imagine that comparing widely different technologies, it's extremely difficult to do so in an objective and robust manner. This is why we had to develop novel performance metrics and establish a framework to compare these different platforms, including the establishment of a set of standardized samples. The ultimate goal of the microRNA quality control study was to help the readers with the guiding form selection for particular study goals. Actually, 12 commercially platforms were measuring 16 standardized samples and 4 optional samples, and 9 novel performance metrics termed M1 to M9 were developed. The core set of common microRNAs across all 12 platforms consisted of 196 microRNAs, and the details of the study were published in Nature Methods last year. Obviously, it's beyond the scope of this webinar to discuss all the aspects of the microRNA quality control study, but I want to highlight 3 important elements. Before I do so, I want to indicate that 3 authors from this microRNA quality control study published in Nature Methods were actually participating at today's webinar. One key element that came out of the key result from the microRNA quality control study is that different performance metrics are either positively or negatively correlated. They are not independent, as depicted here in this clustered heat map. Blue means negative correlation, red means positive correlation, and squares with a white dot mean that these parameters are significantly correlated. Just to give you a few examples, across all 12 platforms, we found out that there is a negative correlation between specificity, M7 parameter, and sensitivity. So if specificity is higher, typically is accompanied with a loss of sensitivity. To the same extent, we observed a positive correlation between accuracy at low concentration, the M4 parameter, and sensitivity at low input, the M6 parameter, as depicted in the figure over here. Apart from observing that performance metrics are correlated, meaning if you tweak one, you may hamper or you may affect the other one, we observed overall good performance for qPCR. Here you see radius plots summarizing all the performance metrics clustered into 4 domains: accuracy, top left, reproducibility, top right, specificity, bottom left, and sensitivity, bottom right. If the lines are more to the outside, means that you have higher performance. And in general, qPCR is fairly good, and especially with respect to accuracy, top left, and sensitivity, bottom right, as depicted here. So each platform, clearly already from this radius plot, has particular advantages and strengths compared to others. The final take-home message from the microRNA quality control study is that we recommend all users to use at least 2 different platforms in screening and validation. And this is because there is not a great concordance when we do differential gene expression analysis. Considering all the microRNAs that are called statistically significantly differentially expressed, comparing subset of the samples, we ended up with 66 microRNAs, but only 2 out of 66, so a mere 3%, were called differentially expressed by all the platforms. About half of the microRNAs seemed concordant in terms of differential expression for about half of the platforms. So in conclusion, we observed variable recall rates of about 1/3 to 2/3 if we compare the results from one platform compared to another platform. So if you do a discovery study using, for instance, sequencing, we definitely recommend to use an orthogonal validation method using another technology to confirm your findings. This way, you will end up with highest accuracy for your final results. Coming back to the statement that PCR had an overall good performance, we noticed especially excellent performance for some aspects of the QIAGEN MyScript qPCR technology. This figure shows the detection rate across the common 196 microRNAs measured across all platforms. And the top, at the very right, QI, meaning QIAGEN, you see the recall rate, and it's about 195 microRNAs that were detected from the common set in the microRNA quantity control sample A, which is a universal reference RNA. So a fairly good detection rate in this universal reference RNA sample. Another good performance was for accuracy at low input. To assess this, we spiked 4 different microRNAs at 2 and 5-fold difference in 2 human serum samples, and we quantified whether we could detect, and at the accurate concentration, these low input, low concentrated spikes. The figure shows that for 3 out of 4, the MyScript technology detected the low concentrated spikes at the correct concentration. Only the lowest concentrated spike was not detected, which was miRNA 133A. Important to note, however, is that no preamplification was introduced in the workflow using mass spec technology in the miRNA quality control study. And the final aspect I want to indicate with respect to performance in the original Merck-UC study is specificity for homologous sequences. Again, we used spikes and we detected or assessed cross-reactivity. With the MyScript system, we observed less than 1% cross-reactivity when 2 to 3 nucleotides are different between closely related family members, and less than 5% cross-reactivity when only one nucleotide is different. Please note that this situation is very rare. It only occurs for very specific LAT7 family. So these performance metrics together indicated that the MyScript technology is quite good, and this is why UGent and Biexcel adopted it for its miRNA quantification studies. We've written a book chapter on how we incorporate the MyScript technology in our own research, which can be read in the book Methods and Molecular Biology from this year in the book Small Non-Coding RNAs. So apart from the performance in the Merck-UC study, the MyScript technology has other strong points, such as that each human miRNA has undergone wet lab validation, the universality of the RT system. So within the reverse transcription system, there's only one signal synthesis for all the miRNAs using the high-spec buffer, but if you wish, you can also generate cDNA for both small and long RNAs, such as messenger RNA and long non-coding RNA, using the high-plex buffer. So it really saves time and cost when you can generate cDNA in just one step for all the RNA species of interest. If sensitivity is important, there is an optional preamplification system to boost sensitivity. And finally, it turns out to be a very flexible system, as you can create custom plates and custom preamp mixes to measure and follow up any combination of human miRNAs in your samples of interest. The miRNA quality control study has definitely a lot of strengths, but also some weaknesses in that the core set only assessed 196 miRNAs. So Biexcel and QIAGEN teamed up to measure all human miRNAs. So we increased 384 miRNAs that were measured by QIAGEN in the original study up to 2,405 miRNAs. We used all these miRNAs to do full profiling of the Merck-UC sample series and on human body fluids, such as serum and cerebrospinal fluid. And we also evaluated the preamp system. Of note, all measurements were done in ISO 17025 accredited lab. I won't discuss all the details in my presentation, but Jonathan will follow up on some of the details of this extension of the miRNA quality control study extension. I do want to indicate that going from 196 miRNA assays up to 2,400 miRNA assays, we do observe good reproducibility. So in the plot left, you see reproducibility between two replicates of the Merck-UC sample A, very tight replicates, and on the right, you see the cumulative fraction and the performance metrics expressed as the ALC, or the area left of the curve, which is the median longitude difference between two replicates. If I would translate that to in the average difference between replicates, that would amount to a 27% difference in quantitative measurements between any two replicates. Considering this is across the entire range of miRNAs, of which many are low abundant, this indicates a very good reproducibility. So the extension measured 8 times more miRNAs, often low abundant, and still obtaining similar reproducibility as the core set of highly abundant Merck-UC miRNAs. Another conclusion from the extension is that the system maintains a good accuracy. Before I can explain what we mean by accuracy, I need to indicate a subset or explain a subset of the Merck-UC sample. So we actually have two pure samples, namely Merck-UC A, which is human universal reference RNA, and Merck-UC B, which is human brain. We mix these pure samples A and B in proportions of 75% of A and 25% B, which is MERQ-C sample C, or 25% of A and 75% of B, which is MERQ-C sample D. Now, the cool thing is that if you can detect a microRNA that is uniquely expressed in sample B, then the D over C ratio has to be 3, because you mix them in predefined proportions. And obviously, if a microRNA is uniquely expressed in A, then the C to D ratio is also 3. So this is really a novel, a very powerful accuracy metric that allows you to assess the accuracy of your quantitative system. So coming to the results, in the original MERQ-C MyScript results, only 9 microRNAs were detected that were uniquely expressed in either sample A or B. Considering these 9 microRNAs, we observed a 20% median deviation from the truth, so the threefold difference that I explained in the previous slide. With the extension now, we identified 150 microRNAs that are uniquely expressed in A or B, so that's 12 times more, and still maintain a pretty good median deviation from truth. We do see an increase from 20 to 36%, but we have to consider that many of these uniquely expressed microRNAs in sample A or B are actually relatively low abundant. So with this performance metric, we were quite happy to see that across the entire range of microRNAs, accuracy is maintained. And then finally, we observe in the extension good sensitivity at low input. The original study used 500 nanograms of total RNA as input in the reverse transcription, and only 384 microRNAs were measured. Here, we tested sensitivity when using only 20 nanograms of total RNA and measured now 768 microRNAs in this sensitivity experiment. So the plot at the bottom depicts the number of microRNAs that are detected in either 20 nanogram, which are 424, or 500 nanogram of total RNA, which are 555 microRNAs. So at 25 times lower input, still 76% of the microRNAs are detected without preamplification, underscoring the sensitivity of the system at low input. With that, I would like to end the extension of the microRNA quality control study, and Jonathan will follow up with more details. But I want to focus now on a use case at Ghent University. We used the MyScript system to study neuroblastoma, an aggressive childhood cancer. Considering neuroblastoma, there are two risk groups, low-risk group, where children have a very good survival probability, and a high-risk group, where half of the children will die despite the intensive multimodal therapies. And the purpose of the study was to use microRNAs circulating the serum of these children with cancer to predict which high-risk patient will benefit from the therapy and survive, and which patient will not and should become eligible for more experimental therapies or more intense follow-up and monitoring. So the experiment design was as follows. We used MyScript profiling to measure the entire microgenome of pooled serum samples from 3 different risk groups: low-risk survivors, high-risk survivors, and high-risk patients that succumb from their disease. Upon doing the full microgenome profiling, we detected 781 microRNAs expressed in the pools. And in the second phase of the study, we did individual profiling of these microRNAs on only 200 microliters of serum, incorporating the preamplification system. For this, we had a training cohort of 2 times 30 patients, 30 children that survived and 30 children that died of aggressive disease, to identify differentially expressed microRNAs and then do the validation on a verification cohort of 78 high-risk patients. These preliminary results indicate that the top 10 differential microRNAs clearly discriminate survival groups. On the left, we discriminate high-risk disease from low-risk survivors, which is not too difficult, but the more challenging and more interesting aspect is that we could, to a high degree of accuracy, discriminate on the right high-risk deceased patients from high-risk survivors. To confirm that this is not an overfitted analysis, we also profiled the independent cohort, and you see the Kaplan-Meier cancer patient survival curves here. On the y-axis, you see the survival probability from 0 to 100%. On the x-axis, the time since the patient was diagnosed with the disease. And applying our predictive model to predict children who will die from their disease, we see a very clear discrimination between the red group with very good survival probabilities, and the blue group with dismal survival probabilities. So we're finalizing the study and drafting a manuscript to submit for publication. I want to end my presentation with a few highlights on BioXcel's microRNA biomarker discovery workflow. And in this workflow, we try to combine the best of both worlds and offer it as a total solution. If you want to have more information, please have a look at the BioXcel website under Lab Services. Combine the best of both worlds, I mean using a unbiased, comprehensive screening technology such as small RNA sequencing and follow-up using sensitive and accurate quantitative PCR using the MyScript qPCR assays. So in phase one, we apply small RNA sequencing to identify differentially expressed microRNAs among sample groups. And in phase two, the validation phase, we use the PCR system to confirm and validate the genes on an independent sample cohort using QIAGEN's MyScript qPCR system. qPCR is an established technology, and I've already indicated it's quite sensitive. However, if we look at the results from sequencing in the MERCUC study, it clearly lacked in terms of sensitivity, where only 100 microRNAs were depicted or were detected in the serum sample. BioXcel has worked hard to get sequencing up to an acceptable level of sensitivity using body fluids. And it's really a combination of tweaking the RNA input, the library prep kit, the library purification, the read depth, the data processing, but also the donor status has an effect on detection, because it turns out that in function of disease state, that more or less microRNAs are detected in body fluids. So on average, we detect between 500 to 800 microRNAs per 200 microliter of serum using QIAGEN's miRNA extraction system. And this is much more than the original 100 microRNAs in the MERCUC study. The plot left bottom shows good reproducibility, even when using RNA from only a tiny fraction of serum. And the right plots indicate that if we increase sequencing depth from 50 million to 25 million, that obviously we detect more microRNAs in the body fluid. So on average, it's 500 to 800. The last few months, we worked incredibly hard to even further improve detection sensitivity. And this final plot shows for two different serum samples the standardized conditions in green with the new improved conditions in pink. And it shows that we can have 30% more microRNAs using our optimized workflow or 15% more microRNAs detected using the optimized workflow. So this brings me to the end of my presentation. I have two concluding slides. Clear conclusion from the microRNA quality control study is that each platform has its own strengths and weaknesses, and there is really no single best or worst platform. The selection of the optimal platform by the user depends on the particular application and the goals of the study, whether low input is important, for instance, serum plasma profiling, whether it's a discovery study or more validation study, and whether, for instance, isomers are important or not. Obviously, apart from technical performance, other things should be considered as well, such as cost, throughput, sample input amount or required input amount, the content size, how many microRNAs are detected anyway, and ease of use of system, and perhaps other parameters that may be relevant for any particular user. And the final concluding slide is that the microRNA quality control study has indicated that PCR technologies have particular advantages for targeted quantification of microRNAs, that the MyScript qPCR technology enables accurate and sensitive quantification of mature microRNAs because it combines flexibility in experiment design with wet lab validated assays, and is a method of choice at Ghent University and BioXcel. And with that, I would like to end my presentation.
Okay, thank you, Joe. As a reminder to webinar participants, if you have a question, please type it into the question field in the control panel. Please do not type your question in the chat field. We will conduct the Q&A portion of the webinar after the presentations are done. Next up is Jonathan Schaefer from QIAGEN. Please proceed, Jonathan.
Thanks a lot. So as an extension to Joe's first portion, I'd like to greatly thank him for joining us today. We'll discuss the miRNA quality control analysis looking at both the QIAGEN and the Exicon platforms. For my agenda, what I would want to begin with is a very brief overview of QIAGEN solutions for miRNA analysis, followed up by the features of the Microscript PCR system. We'll then discuss the miRQC, QIAGEN, and Exicon platform extension, and finish up with a brief overview of miRNA quantification workflow recommendations, as well as a summary of QIAGEN's product offerings. Before we continue, I'd like to thank BioGazelle for, again, joining us for today, and also for performing the additional miRNA control extension, as well as GenomeWeb for hosting today's webinar. First off, let's take a look at QIAGEN's sample-to-insight solutions for miRNA analysis. These solutions enable the analysis of any miRNA from any sample. Starting from left to right, we have our sample prep tech.
Everyone, please stand by. We're having some technical difficulties. Please stand by, please. Peter, are you there?
I'm here.
Okay, great. Everyone on the webinar, this is we're talking with Peter Mestock, who is a senior data analysis expert at BioGazelle and a postdoctoral researcher at Ghent University and a collaborator of Dr. Vandesompele. While we try and get Jonathan back on the webinar, we do have a question in regarding Joe's presentation. We're hoping that you could answer it. Did you look at any other predictive biomarkers for neuroblastoma? And if so, how did they perform compared to the miRNA markers?
Yeah, so we did indeed. Basically in serum, what we actually looked at is only microRNAs, but we always incorporate the current clinical variables in our equation and evaluate whether our microRNA signature is indeed independent of these current clinical variables, such as the stage of the disease, age of the patient, and so on. In serum, we did not measure additional biomarkers. However, we did a similar study in biopsies, tumor biopsies from these patients, so not body fluids but biopsies. And there we did measure both microRNA and messenger RNA expression. And so we came up with both a messenger RNA classifier and a microRNA classifier that both have their specific application. So the microRNA classifier appears to work very well on formalin fixed paraffin embedded tissue as well, whereas the mRNA classifier is more suited for fresh frozen samples. But so for the serum, we only measure microRNA, but we do incorporate additional clinical variables into our models.
Okay, great. Thank you, Peter. Appreciate you answering that question for us. If the attendees could please stand by for just a moment, we believe we're going to have Jonathan Schaefer back with us momentarily. Thank you. Okay, everyone. Sorry for the delays here. There's a technical issue on Jonathan's end. I do have another question, Peter, to ask you. One of our attendees said, I'm going to do a follow-up study on microRNA profiling in gestational diabetic subjects by frozen serum sample. MyScript Cyber Green PCR kit and using MyScript miRNA PCR array, I need more details about pooling samples technique by screening and validation.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So they want to know, yeah.
Yeah, so basically the whole idea behind this pooling strategy is that you first run on a limited number of samples, which are pools of representative samples from your entire cohort. You run a, let's say, a discovery phase where you define which microRNAs are expressed in your sample, and you do so by using miRNome arrays, so where you can measure all 2,400 and something microRNAs in your, let's say, a representative collection of samples, which you can pool to further limit the number of samples that you need to measure. Because the benefit of doing so is that by determining upfront which microRNAs are actually expressed in your samples of interest, you can drastically limit the number of assays you need to pay for when screening your entire cohort and your entire population. So what we typically see is when screening for 2,400 microRNAs in representative sample pools, we typically end up with anywhere between, let's say, 600 and 800 microRNAs that are robustly expressed in our population. And that allows us to drastically scale down the experiment and only measure what is actually expressed. Because if you would do the opposite and profile or all 2,400 assays on all your samples, a lot of data would be lost because two-thirds of your assays would not give you any usable data because those microRNAs would not be expressed anyway. So it's really a matter of saving money and saving precious samples. That's basically the reason behind this whole setup. If you want more information on how this is done in practice, I suggest that you can visit, for instance, the BioGazelle website under services, as Joe mentioned in his presentation, and get in touch with some of the people from the BioGazelle service team to further help you on the way on how this is actually done. I hope this answers the question.
Okay, great. Thank you, Peter. Appreciate it. We believe we have Jonathan Schaefer back. Jonathan,
yes.
Are you there?
Yes.
Okay, great. You can you can proceed with your presentation. Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks a lot. Yeah, despite your best efforts for phone consistency and network consistency, sometimes things happen. So appreciate everybody for staying. I see the participant list hasn't dropped. So let's continue on here. So if I summarizing up this slide, as I probably talked about portion of the slide, sample prep for any sample, real-time PCR for any microRNA, data analysis that's free through our GeneGlobe Center, and data interpretation. So instead of just providing you sample through data analysis, we enable interpretation of your data as well using the Ingenuity pathway analysis. Also, through our service core, we can have classifier algorithm development performed for your biomarker studies. Also, I'd like to mention, coming soon, we have a single-cell microRNA analysis where we will be enabling universal quantification for precision microRNA profiling from individual cells. So what are some of the features of the QIAGEN microscript system? We enable animal microRNA, plant microRNA, and piRNA quantification. And as a result, you have a quantification system that is available for whatever small RNA you're interested in. The backbone of our kit is universal RT reaction, meaning that there's no need to pre-select your microRNAs of interest. Third, we have a preamplification option that Joe previously discussed, which this enables microRNA signatures in low RNA content samples. Fourth, whether you have a low, medium, or high throughput experiment, we offer a platform for this, whether you're looking at individual assays, our pre-formatted PCR arrays for medium throughput, or our high-throughput solution on the Fluidigm biomark, we have a solution. We blend our bioinformatic capacity for biology-focused arrays, which enables you to spend more time on experimental execution and data interpretation as opposed to experimental design. Our up-to-date microgenome array and up-to-date mirror-based assay coverage enables novel microRNA discovery. As Joe mentioned, we offer more than 2,400 primer assays. We also offer free data analysis, as well as microRNA mimics, inhibitors, and target protectors that enable you to rapidly follow up on interesting microRNA expression analysis results. And lastly, all of our products are fully customizable. Whether you're looking at annotated microRNAs that you want to focus a panel or on novel microRNAs that you actually want a de novo primer sequence designed, whether that be for primer assays, mimics, or inhibitors, we have flexible solutions to meet your needs. But all these features are well and good, but how does QIAGEN stack up performance-wise? And to assess this, we performed a extension of the microRNA quality control analysis using both the QIAGEN and the Exicon platforms. We chose these two basically because both of them rely on a universal reverse transcription reaction. The testing, again, was performed by BioGazelle. The platforms were for QIAGEN, the microscript PCR system with and without preamplification, and the Exicon mercury LNA microRNA qPCR system. As a note, the experiments were performed in accordance with each manufacturer's product manual. The samples that were assessed were the MAQC A through D, which Joe had previously discussed, cerebrospinal fluid, which I'll refer to as CSF, as well as serum. Data processing was in accordance with the original MIR-QC study, where a platform-specific CT cutoff was derived for each platform, and the data was normalized using the global mean. To directly compare the platforms, a common set of 746 assays was assessed. The QIAGEN microgenome arrays offer more than 2,400 primer assays, and the exocon microgenome arrays offer 752. And from this combination of 2,400 and 752, a common set of 746 was assessed. So first off, let's take a look at reproducibility and titration response using the MAQC samples, which are, again, universal human microRNA reference RNA, human brain RNA, and combinations of both. So for reproducibility, at the top here, we have the QIAGEN between two replicates across all four of the MAQC samples, as well as the exocon replicates. As you can see, both platforms demonstrate a comparable reproducibility with a very similar ALC. At the bottom, we have titration response, and titration response involves the MAQC samples. So MAQC-A is universal human reference RNA, and MAQC-B is human brain RNA. MAQC-C is 75% A and 25% B, and D is 25% A and 75% B. And a titration implies that you are correctly calling the order of the samples. So for example, if you have an assay in sample A that has greater expression than B, if you compare all four samples, A would be greater than C, which would be greater than D, which would be greater than B. And the ability to detect the correct sample order is defined as titration response. So what we have here in the figure is that the microRNAs were binned according to expression differences in MAQC-A versus B, and we plotted the fraction of titrating microRNAs, meaning that the microRNA was calling the appropriately correct sample order. And as you can see, both platforms demonstrate comparable titration response. Lastly, both platforms demonstrate comparable accuracy, although I have not shown this here. So the question you may now have is, okay, we've seen three points where the platforms are similar. What separates the platforms? First off, we took a look at detection rate and sensitivity measured by double positives and single positives across the MAQC samples. Again, here we're assessing a common set of 746 assays, and the QIAGEN platform exhibits a significantly greater number of double positives than exocon. Exocon has approximately 400 double positives across the samples, while the QIAGEN platform exhibited slightly more than 600 double positives. And when you consider the entire QIAGEN portfolio of more than 2,400 assays, the number of double positives is well higher. Looking at single positives, this again is a measure of sensitivity as well as detection rate. The QIAGEN platform exhibited approximately half of the single positives observed for the exocon system. Collectively, this, you can conclude that the QIAGEN platform demonstrates superior detection and sensitivity. And the bottom line for you is that this enables greater opportunity to discover novel microRNA signatures. Last, what I would like to discuss is biofluid detection. As Joe mentioned, and it's widely published, microRNA biofluid detection is an area of hot interest. Not only are microRNAs expressed in virtually all biofluids, they're stably expressed, and their expression is tied to both normal and disease biology. So looking at microRNA quantification in cerebrospinal fluid and serum samples, QIAGEN exhibits a higher number of reproducibly detected microRNAs in CSF samples. Looking at the left chart here for CSF samples A and B, exocon detected approximately 35 or so microRNAs in CSF A and approximately 25 in B. And in contrast, the QIAGEN platform detected nearly 150 in A and about 137 in B. So overall for CSF samples, you achieve fourfold more results with the QIAGEN platform. For the serum samples, a very similar story. Serum samples A and B, approximately 80 for exocon, and approximately 250 and 300 respectively for A and B for the QIAGEN platforms. Overall, you have a threefold increase in results with the QIAGEN platform. and I always like to refer back to the entire QIAGEN portfolio. When you consider the entire portfolio of more than 2,400 assays, the number of reproducibly detected microRNAs is at least tenfold higher. Collectively, QIAGEN demonstrates a superior detection rate in biofluids, and the bottom line is that this enables sensitive, specific detection of microRNAs from low RNA content samples. In summary, we performed an extension of the microRNA quality control analysis using the QIAGEN and the Exicon platforms. Both platforms exhibit comparable reproducibility, titration response, and accuracy. What separated the platforms was the QIAGEN platform exhibited a superior detection rate and sensitivity with more double positives and significantly less single positives. For detection rate in biofluids, looking at a common set of assays, you achieved at least threefold more results with the QIAGEN platform when a common set of assays was assessed. Looking at the entire portfolio, considered at least tenfold more results with QIAGEN. Collectively, QIAGEN's microscript PCR system is your leading solution for novel microRNA discoveries, offering both unique flexible solutions and superior performance. But we don't stop there. We also offer expression profiling workflows for standard samples. These would be your cells and tissues, your low RNA content samples, serum and plasma samples, urine, cerebrospinal fluid, and other fluids, as well as biomarker discovery. And for details on these protocols, email me at jonathan.schaefer@QIAGEN.com. In addition, Joe discussed this as well, we are strong proponents of a three-phase workflow from sample to classifier. In phase one, this is a great way to narrow your results to exactly what you should be looking at for your particular sample. In essence, say you're interested in breast cancer, you would be creating a breast cancer-specific microgenome. Phase one is a qualitative determination of expressed microRNAs using a pooled sample profiling approach. You can either choose qPCR microgenome profiling or small RNA sequencing. And again, phase one is simply to qualitatively determine what microRNAs are expressed. Phase two is where you first quantitatively determine what is differentially expressed. This involves individual profiling of the samples that went into the pools, and you'll be only screening the expressed microRNAs from phase one. This funnels into phase three, then, where you develop and test your classifier. This involves additional individual profiling of samples to both refine and test your algorithm, and you'll be screening only your differentially expressed microRNAs from phase two. At the bottom of the funnel, you're obviously moving from phase one through three, but you're also narrowing your assays so you can focus in on what exactly matters and what is specific for your experimental platform. I'd like to, again, just summarize here the QIAGEN sample-to-insight solutions for microRNA analysis. For sample prep, we offer solutions for any sample type, real-time PCR for any assay, whether it's annotated or novel, free data analysis software, and the ability to interpret your data as well. So from sample to insight, you can rely on the QIAGEN detection platform. And again, I'd like to thank you for attending today's webinar. I would encourage you to write down my email, jonathan.schaefer@QIAGEN.com.
Okay, thank you, Jonathan. Before we enter the Q&A session, we want to ask attendees to please take a moment to take our exit survey after the webinar has ended to give us your feedback. Okay, we're going to enter the Q&A portion of the webinar. As I noted earlier, Joe Vandesompele is unable to join us for the Q&A. However, his colleague, Peter Mestock, is available to answer questions. The first question is for Peter. Peter, can you discuss the options for miRNA studies in FFPE samples versus fresh frozen?
Yes, sure. So for FFPE samples, we basically were very successful by applying qPCR technology for microRNA detection quantification. As I already mentioned in one of the, or in my reply to one of the previous questions, One of the studies that Joe presented on the serum miRNA study in neuroblastoma patients, we did exactly the same but on FFPE samples from neuroblastoma patients. And there we were very successful in both quantifying and miRNAs and actually establishing a very accurate classifier for outcome prediction of these patients. So we have less experience with small RNA sequencing or microRNA or hybridization-based technologies on FFPE. What I do know from our limited experience is that with small RNA sequencing, you might run into various obstacles such as detection of degraded RNA fragments in your small RNA sample prep. So with qPCR, basically we don't see any issues in quantifying miRNA expression in FPE samples. So I think today I would say that my first choice of method for miRNA profiling in FFPE would be qPCR. Although I do not exclude that by further developments and adaptations of small RNA sequencing protocols, these methods would also be applicable to those types of samples.
Okay, thank you, Peter. Jonathan, a question for you. Regarding QIAGEN's biofluid detection being fourfold higher, did you perform orthogonal confirmation for that?
No, we did not perform for that. What we used the two sample types just to see that it wasn't an aberration in one versus the other, also taking into account the double positives and the single positives, that any result that you see was a result of a double positive. It isn't just a raw one data point. But as Joe had mentioned, it's always good to perform an additional follow-up platform, and this is the value of relying on multiple technologies such as NGS and qPCR. So going forward, you would expect an additional follow-up study on what this was observed for both the Exicon and the QIAGEN platforms.
Okay, thank you. Also, Jonathan, somebody else checked in and said, do you check the milk curve of your assays and how many display multiple peaks in the milk curve?
Sure. So the data was processed by BioGazelle and a platform-specific CT cutoff was applied. And for the specific milk curves for this study, I'm not aware whether that was done or not, but what we typically recommend is to always look at the milk curves. This is a great quality control and is only afforded by the CyberGreen technologies. Now, in the past more than half a decade here, looking at milk curves with respect to an experimentally, a platform-specific CT cutoff, the milk curves that are more robust, the milk curves for the assays that are more robust than the CT limit of detection, double peaks are few and far between for the microscript PCR system. Now, beyond the cutoff, I believe the cutoff for the system study here was 30 to 34. Beyond the cutoff, there may be double melts, but again, this is in the background. But looking at the actual quantifiable range, the melt curves are very highly specific, and this is one of the main proponents of using the high-spec buffer technology for reverse transcription, that it suppresses often most, if not all, of the background sequences that can leave you with a double peak in your melt curves.
Okay, thank you. Jonathan, also another question for you. Can you quantify total RNA amounts from fluids, and how much total RNA from serum, plasma, or other fluids do you recommend analyzing in qPCR?
Sure. That's a great question. So from serum, plasma, and other cell-free fluids, your usual RNA species aren't there. So what we would consider to be, when you're looking traditionally at cells and tissues, your total RNA, quote-unquote, is different than what you're seeing in fluids. You don't have a lot of ribosomal RNA and tRNAs that are giving you the concentration readings in fluids. So while you can certainly use a nanodrop or other metric for concentration readings, the concentration reading isn't indicative of a true, what we would traditionally consider, total RNA. So as a result, what we normally do is a volume equivalent. And what we use as a rule of thumb is for serum and plasma, we use 20 microliters of serum equivalents per intended 384 well plate of assays. So what that means, if you isolate from 200 microliters of serum or plasma, you reverse transcribe 1/10 of your RNA elute per intended 384 well plate. And this is pretty well standard across the industry and is a great way to approach biofluids.
Okay, great. Thanks, Jonathan. Another one for you. For full change calculations, what are your data normalization recommendations for fluids?
Sure. This is another great question. For data normalization in biofluids, it's different than working with cells or tissues. That for cells or tissues, you can simply use small non-coding RNAs such as SNO RNAs or snRNAs. However, in biofluids, these aren't robustly expressed. And as a result, you can use a global CT mean for normalization or invariant microRNAs for data normalization. And you can choose an algorithm like NormFinder or other programs to identify invariant microRNAs. But again, for biofluids, the best choices would either be a global CT mean if you're working with hundreds of assays, or invariant microRNAs when you're working with small panels of assays.
Can I just add to that so we've done some research in that and published about this global mean strategy as well, and what we've seen is that, especially for body fluids, is that the modified global mean, which basically takes into account the expression intensity of the individual microRNAs that contribute to the mean calculation, so this modified global mean, which is more robust than the straightforward global mean CT, appears to be much more robust, especially for body fluids. So this is something you might want to check out. We've written a book chapter on that, and there's also a blog on the BioGazel website about the modified global mean and how to apply that.
Okay, great. Thank you. Peter, just another question. Are there future phases planned for the miRQC study?
Well, the only additional or additions to the microRNA quality control study that might be published in the future are basically two additional platforms representatives of those platforms got in touch with us and asked us if we could do the analysis of the different parameters on their platform. So this is ongoing, but it's too early days to give you any definite feedback on if that will be published and when that will be published. But besides from that, we don't have any real plans on extending the microRNA quality control study even further.
Okay, thank you, Peter. We have come to the end of the time allotted for the webinar. We'd like to thank our panelists today, Joe Vandesompele, Jonathan Schaefer, and we'd like to thank Peter Mestock for joining us in the Q&A, as well as our sponsor, QIAGEN. If we didn't have time to get to your questions, we'll try to have the panelists answer them directly afterward. And as a reminder, please look out for the pop-up survey from the sponsor after you log out. If you missed any part of this webinar or wish to listen to it again, a link to an archived version will be emailed to attendees. We thank you all for joining this genome webinar.